Good morning and a very warm welcome to the 26th meeting of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2023. And our first agenda item this morning is pre-budget scrutiny of the 24-25 Scottish Government budget. Our first agenda item, we have two evidence sessions this morning for this session. The first one, we are joined by Ian Munro, Chief Executive of Creative Scotland, and Isabel Davis, Executive Director of Creative Scotland. And a warm welcome to you both this morning. If I could begin with, we had a supplementary submission from you yesterday, and it outlined the proposed £6.6 million reduction in the grant aid for 2023-24. It had been reversed, was our understanding, but that cut has now been reinstated. And I just if I'd ask Mr. Munro to outline what impact that will have on Creative Scotland.
Good morning, convener and committee. Thank you again for inviting Isabel and I to come and give evidence this morning. So, yes, we thought it was important to keep the committee informed of this news in our submission yesterday. So, just to explain, this is indeed a reduction of £6.6 million in year for Creative Scotland's budget. It is the same £6.6 million that had been originally planned as a reduction in Creative Scotland's budget in the budget setting process for 2023, but reversed in February of this year. It was always subject to confirmation through the autumn budget revisions. But what we've now got confirmation of is that the £6.6 million is not included in the autumn budget revisions and that the reduction is being reinstated. So a very significant development. I should explain, and I'm happy to explain further about the overall way in which our budgets work, but as a proportion, that is against our total combined income from the Scottish Government, that's roughly 10%. But the way in which our budgets work, this hits a very specific part of our budgets, which is support for regularly funded organisations, of which we now have 119. So proportionately, that is around a 20% cut for a full 12-month period. But given that the reduction is now coming in halfway through the year, what that would translate into is in effect a 40% reduction that we would apply in a reduction to our support for regularly funded organisations for the next two payments that we would be making in this financial year. And just to be clear, we make four payments a year, they're quarterly. And because we haven't had confirmation of the £6.6 million position until now, it would therefore have to impact the last 6 months of the year, which would be the two final payments and a reduction of 40%. Clearly, that is enormous in terms of the fragility that already exists in the sector and would in effect act as a tipping point for what we've submitted in writing before, and I've also spoken with this committee about before, in terms of the risks to organisational closures, loss of employment, opportunities for artists, audiences and provision, and much more beyond. So the Board of Creative Scotland met yesterday. The Cabinet Secretary was able to attend the very first part of that meeting to discuss this matter. And after the Cabinet Secretary left, the Board of Creative Scotland had very detailed conversations about what the options are available to Creative Scotland. And in recognition of the devastation that would result from handing on a 40% cut in 2 weeks' time, which would be the next RFO payment, they have acted swiftly on the back of this news and pragmatically, and have agreed as a one-off to utilise £6.6 million of our National Lottery reserves to offset that reduction. But I want to stress it is a one-off. Reserves, clearly by their very nature, can only be used once. But it will enable us to maintain the payment for the RFOs as planned without the cap being applied. I want to also say that because of its nature being a one-off, if the cuts were to continue, if there were budget reductions, we would have to pass them on to the sector. Our own financial resilience and that of the sector as a whole is depleted. So I think we are at a very significant moment in this evidence around the heightening of the risks that exist within the sector.
Okay, I'm going to go straight to questions from the rest of the committee. If anyone would like to come in, please indicate. We'll bring in Ms Forbes and then Mr Cameron first.
Thanks very much and good morning. Could I ask just a quick series of questions to clarify some of the points that you have made? The first is, you mentioned that you allocate funding four times a year and the next allocation is in 2 weeks' time. And so were the organisations expecting that funding in full on the basis of the additional £6.6 million? Or had they still to receive confirmation?
So it's one annual grant award that is in effect paid over four tranches on a quarterly basis. So we have an annual contract with these regularly funded organisations that would set out the figure for the year. Based on the February reversal of the planned reduction, we have indicated the full year's commitment to the regularly funded organisations. So they would and have been expecting their third quarterly payment based on that full allocation in 2 weeks' time.
Cash rather than of budget. In other words, the cash is allocated rather than a budget being agreed in 2 weeks' time.
Understood.
Yeah. And then just in terms of reserves, what impact will it have on reserves? I take your point that it's a one-off and by its nature reserves shouldn't be used for ongoing resource payments. But what sort of percentage or proportion of reserves does that £6.6 million form?
So just to be clear, as I'm sure the committee will be aware, we don't have the opportunity to build reserves on our Scottish Government income, but we do through our National Lottery income. It varies in terms of the extent of the reserves that we accumulate for different strategic purposes. These reserves have been accumulated specifically to ease the transition to the new funding model for multi-year arrangements that we've been planning for some time and is now up and running as a process. Because we know that, and we've been very clear in our messaging, that we anticipate, unless there's a significant change in overall budget levels, that we're not going to be able to sustain the levels of support that we have been in the past for as many organisations or certainly to the level that we have. So in respect of that, the transition funds that would be resourced from the National Lottery reserves have now been impacted. And those transition funds are to support those organisations that are unsuccessful in their multi-year application to avoid a cliff edge when their current funding commitments end and to give them a wee bit of financial support to bring in expertise and for themselves to think about what their options are for the future. So it's definitely not now, it's significantly reduced in terms of the amount available to support that transition activity. But what we will continue to do, because this is a one-off regarding the 6.6 million and our use of reserves to offset that, we are protecting the balance of that reserves position to enable transition support as far as we reasonably can.
Thanks. And are you able to share the reserves position? Yeah. In terms of quantum?
Yeah, as per the committee submission, £17 million has been the allocated reserve for transition. It does fluctuate over a period up to around £20 million. But £6.6 million is now unavailable for the transition reserve that we had allocated.
Thanks. And if I could just ask one last question. I had a quick look at the correspondence. I wasn't here at the time, but from the Finance Secretary. allocating the additional £6.6 million, which I believe was in March, but you may want to correct me, which is quite close, of course, to the beginning of the financial year. And did that allow you to reinstate organisations that would otherwise have received nothing, or was it a case of increasing the quantum that was available to all the organisations that you fund?
It was the latter. So it was February, rather than March. And what it enabled, because we've had recurring years of regular funding support at a certain level, we've been in, the objective is to be able to maintain at least a standstill position on that. Appreciate it's a real terms reduction when you account for inflation and so on, but what it enabled us to do was to maintain year on year from last year into this year the same resource allocation for those 119 regularly funded organisations. If the 6.6 million hadn't been available to us, we would have had the same choice, either use reserves at that time or to pass that reduction on to the funding allocation for those regularly funded organisations.
So from an organisation's perspective, they'll see no impact from this decision in the short term?
It stabilises the situation, but I think it'd be worth noting the effect of the news of this will deepen the concern that exists within the sector. It will add to the concerns about confidence and forward planning, which is so critical to enable the cultural sector to function, to have such a significant in-year adjustment. If we hadn't been in the position of being able to allocate our National Lottery reserves, the cut would have been passed on, as I say, at 40%. And it would have inevitably seen the tipping point for, in our estimate, probably up to half of the current regularly funded organisations. But because we have been able to use the 6.6 million, it's stabilised the position until the end of this financial year. But what's not clear is what the position will be for 24-25 onwards. And as I say, if reductions were to continue, then we'll have no option then but to pass it on. So it's a very short-term intervention by Creative Scotland to stabilise and give confidence for as best we can for the rest of this year, but it's not certain at all beyond that.
Thank you.
I'm going to bring Mr Cameron in there, bring Mr Bibby. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Just so I'm clear, you're using 6.6 million of approximately 17 million of reserves. Is that right? It's about a third of your reserves that you're using.
Yeah, the reserves are about 20 million. In total, just since the update we gave you, it's 17 million.
Okay. Yeah. And the reinstatement of this cut now, it essentially means, boiled down, that you've had a reprieve of just over 7 months. Is that right?
A reprieve in?
In terms of funding. It's lasted 7 months, and now you know that the cut has been reinstated.
So the resource that was available to us for the first 6 months of the year has enabled us to make the first two quarterly payments to the regularly funded organisations. So I wouldn't interpret that as a reprieve in a sense. What it enabled us to do was have confidence to be able to make those payments. But we're now in a position that we needed confidence for the last 6 months of the year.
So we heard evidence last week from Liam Sinclair of the Federation of Scottish Theatre, and he said, in relation to the initial 10% cut and then the reversal of the cut in February, he said this: it would be difficult to overstate the erosion of faith and trust among our members that resulted from that journey. What do you think will be the reaction of people like him, people he represents in the sector, to the news that this cut is being reinstated, in your words?
So there's some early reaction, and you will clearly be taking evidence from sector colleagues later this morning, and you'll be able to hear directly. But some of the early reaction is far from positive. I think there is despair. There is despondency. I think there's disillusionment. There's a fear. People are exhausted in trying to keep the show on the road, literally. And what, as I've already mentioned, what's vital is forward planning confidence. So to have uncertainties, even with some months' notice, but, you know, with short-term uncertainties, it's only adding to the pressures and risks that people are having to manage directly in the sector, and it's not sustainable. I mean, in our evidence, we've given you illustrations based on the regularly funded organisations that those that are so financially fragile are at risk. I think in these situations, as the perfect storm continues, and I've got to say it's growing stronger, the risks are increasing all of the time in relation to the potential for parts of the sector to be unsustainable, and we see the decline of the sector in the months and indeed years ahead unless there is a change in the resourcing equation.
And in practical terms, decline, does that mean, what does that mean? Does that mean closures?
Closures, job losses, loss of provision, less available for communities right across the country, less opportunities for artists, as well as those employed directly within the organisations. It means less ability to reach into other policy areas where we know culture has such an important role to play, health and education, for example. It means less in terms of the spillover effects that culture, the role that culture plays across cultural, social and economic impacts in tourism as well, for example, hospitality, as well as Scotland's international reputation, which is so strong in relation to our cultural identity. So I think there's more at stake on the ground in terms of local provision and the loss for audiences and employment and organisations, but more beyond that in terms of the consequences as a result of a strong cultural offer. So I think it's potentially very damaging if there is decline in the sector on all fronts.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Mr. Bibby, and then Mr. Alexander.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Obviously, we've had a U-turn in February and we've had a U-turn on the U-turn, so it's no wonder there's a erosion of trust within the sector. You mentioned, Mr. Munro, that the Cabinet Secretary was at the meeting yesterday. Did the Cabinet Secretary give an explanation as to this?
Yes. I would want to say to the committee very clearly, we do not underestimate the pressures on public finances. Hard choices are, of course, having to be made. There are pressures on all fronts. I think this is, in that context, it's very much understood that there are hard choices being made. And there are inflationary pressures, pay settlements that are all adding to the pressures on public finances. So that's the contextual backdrop that is the explanation from the Scottish Government in relation to the inability now for the Scottish Government to provide the £6.6 million.
Obviously, a commitment was given in February, and you've talked about the pressures that the Cabinet Secretary discussed with you yesterday, and you mentioned pay there. So this budget is potentially getting used for pay settlements elsewhere in the public sector. Is that your understanding?
Well, there's not a direct line of sight. I mean, we need to be very clear. £6.6 million is a meaningful, significant sum of funding, and the cultural sector makes every pound work doubly hard in terms of the value that it delivers. But it's overstretched, and £6.6 million in an overall Scottish Government budget of £60 billion is proportionately very, very small. I should be clear that Creative Scotland's budget as a proportion of the overall Scottish Government budget has now tipped below 0.1% of the overall total expenditure of the Scottish Government. The creative economy as a whole, I think it is also worth talking about. We have a role to play, amongst others, in helping to support the creative economy to thrive, not just the cultural economy, but the creative economy. And that creative economy for Scotland is very significant. And at UK level, it's a growth sector. There are over 13,000 created businesses in Scotland, employing around 80,000 people, that's 80,000 people, and generating nearly £4.5 billion net GVA for the Scottish economy. The return on investment that comes through funding to Creative Scotland as part of that overall equation is enormous, and what these small sums of money do is unlock a lot of potential. But because the budgets that are available to us haven't been able to keep up, even with inflation, our budgets have been at relative standstill, the unrestricted budgets, for over 10 years. There's an inbuilt deficit already within the equation. And so when these cuts of small numbers then emerge, they have a disproportionately negative impact on the effects for not just culture, but for social benefits and for the economy. So it's in a context of a much bigger equation that I think we need to understand.
And obviously the promise was made in February. You got confirmation in writing on the 27th, or yesterday, about the cut not being reinstated. Have you any indication of when a decision was made in government about that, or for how long they've been looking at not reinstating this cut? Because clearly the Cabinet Secretary didn't wake up yesterday morning and say, I'm going to cut 6.6 million from the Creative Scotland's budget, did he?
So we got the confirmation letter on the 20th, so a week ago, essentially. Yeah. As I said at the top of the evidence session, the technical reality was that the Deputy First Minister at the time, as Finance Secretary, confirmed the 6.6 million, but it was subject to the autumn budget revision. So the Scottish Government have had, through the course of 23-24 since April, to explore how the 6.6 million was going to be provided. And then clearly the autumn budget revision has not secured the 6.6 million, and hence the letter to us confirming it is not available after all.
Thank you.
Mr. Shute.
6.6 million is considerable, and you've identified that within the process this morning, Mr. Monroe, and I thank you for that. But the shock waves that you and the sector must have experienced when that decision was reversed, and you were losing that, and I commend you for at least filling the gap, which you've managed to do. But the death knell to some of the sector without you filling that gap would have been considerable. You've identified that this morning. Does it feel that the sector is under attack? It's expendable. It's not seen as a priority by this government? Because that would appear to be the message that is being transmitted to you as a sector. Now, you've talked about how you're successful, and you do and you have done as a sector, and that's to be commended as well. But how do you measure that success when you get something like this thrown at you? Because economic growth, involvement, the development of the sector. How can the sector progress when it is put in this? It's a life death situation. You either survive or you don't. And if you hadn't put that money into the sector, then some of these organisations would no longer exist at the end of this financial year.
Yes, that's correct. And that's why the board have moved as swiftly as it can to stabilise the situation. But as I said earlier, it is for a short term, you're right. And I've talked about the planning confidence that's required. These kind of interventions of change are a bit like trying to change the engines on an airplane whilst you're flying it. And if I can stick with an airline analogy, perhaps, I think the planning confidence I'm talking about is we don't know what the funding landing strip is that we're aiming for. Is it of a scale of a Glasgow International Airport or a regional airport like Aberdeen or Inverness, or is it indeed Barra Beach? We've got to understand what the future looks like to be able to navigate with more confidence, whatever the final settlement picture looks like. So multi-year commitments are really important for us as well as for others. I think a few points in addition. I think there is, I mean, I've talked about the despair and despondency and so on, but I think there is confusion out there in relation to the very clear and bold statements of value and support for the cultural sector compared to the realities of the resource that's available to support its sustenance and indeed development and growth and the contribution that it can confidently make to culture, but to society and the economy. I think clearly there is concern that we're all talking about here. In terms of what's at risk, the potential for decline and the damage that indicates, the loss of opportunity as well as the reputational damage around the world. And I think because there is inherent ambition in the sector, and for those that are getting support, they are doing their very best to not just keep going, but deliver the very best work. And they need to be thanked and commended for that. But that too is now at risk. And I think people are starting to feel very compromised in their ability to continue delivering whilst this uncertainty on the funding commitment continues to exist.
At last week's meeting, you probably heard that there was talk about how Scotland gets it when it comes to culture. Well, my stark review of this today is that Scotland doesn't get it, if that's the way you are treated by the government of the day. As I said, you as a sector have bent over backwards to accommodate and be supportive and take on board many of the areas. And you've been innovative and you continue to do that. You punch above your weight. We discussed that last week as well. But you cannot maintain, sustain and retain if you do not know where you're going. And it's quite obvious at the moment that that route plan is not available to you as an organisation or to the sector. And how can you plan and progress if you don't have that?
Yeah, with extreme difficulty. I think I can genuinely say that I believe the Scottish Government gets it, to use your phrase, from previous evidence. There are challenges, I've acknowledged, on all fronts, but it is very clear the value that is returned. I've talked about some of it, and other evidence gives you more. But it's not translating into the resource equation. You know, the overall cultural budget is about 0.6%. So ours is just tipped below 0.1% of overall Scottish Government expenditure. Culture budget as a whole, I think, if I've done my arithmetic correctly, is about 0.6%. If we look at comparators, is very interesting. You know, the European average is of 34 countries that I've been analysing is 1.5%. That's the European average. We're way off that. So I know Culture Counts has put forward its own view on resourcing levels that would be helpful. I come at it from a different perspective, and I would certainly support what Culture Counts have put forward. But I think based on that international comparator and what we know would be an exponential return on investment if the sector is backed, then an aim to get the culture budget up to 1% of total Scottish Government expenditure should be an objective. If we're all able to see that commitment, then we can know and understand what it is that the funding landing strip looks like.
Thank you.
Mr. Brown.
Thanks very much. Just a few quick questions. Just on the last point you made, you've given the comparator between Scotland and the European average. Do you know what the relevant figures are for the rest of the UK in terms of the percentage of the UK budget spent on culture and within that Wales?
Yeah, so similar-ish. I should be clear that direct, like-for-like international comparisons are very, very difficult. But when you look at the detail, and our colleagues that are experts in this have tried to get the average across the piece. Across the UK, it's similar-ish. But what we have seen is Most recently, a 2% uplift for our equivalent in England, and nearly a 3% uplift in our equivalent in Wales. I think there's another, because you specifically mentioned Wales, I think there's another bit of context that's worth sharing, and I've mentioned it in past evidence to this committee. But in Wales, there is a kind of policy framework in legislation now called the Wellbeing of Future Generations Act. It's from 2015. And what it requires is policy areas beyond culture to have an eye to culture when it is planning for its service provision and delivery. It's the same with the environment, for example, as well. And it acts as an inbuilt trigger for culture to have a reference point within policy areas beyond culture, so automatically in health or education. And it's it is, by its very title, a generational approach, but it absolutely means that we know the value that exists in these other policy areas, which are part of the value and the impact, but also the resource equation, can be unlocked in that kind of framework. So I would draw that to the committee's attention.
The question I was asking was about the comparator with England and Wales, and you said it was equivalent. Were you saying that England and Wales or the UK and Wales is equivalent to the European average or to what's spent in Scotland?
To the Scotland figure. Yeah.
In relation to your reserves, I think you said that the entirety of the reserves, and this is what I think you said, correct me if I'm wrong, the entirety of the reserves comes down to the National Lottery. No part of the reserves has been contributed by Scottish Government funding, is that right?
That's correct, yes.
And can you say, you mentioned the UK context and the sector across the UK. You said it was important to have context. We've had 13 years of austerity budgets where budgets have declined. Do you think that the culture sector, because there's some pretty challenging stuff in here and in what you've been saying about the Scottish Government, do you think they're being, I think in the words of Alexander Stewart, attacked by the Scottish Government or seen as expendable? But do you think they're being treated differently from other parts of the budget?
As I say, I think everybody knows and understands the context, and people make a confident contribution as best they can based on the resourcing levels, and they of course understand the tough choices that are having to be made. Do they feel under attack? I would let the sector express that for themselves, but I think what they do feel is under challenge to make sense of the very clear statements of public support and a resource equation that has been in net effect in decline for 10 years plus, knowing the value that and return on investment that exists, and actually in relative terms these are small but meaningful sums of money that have an exponential return on that investment. So I think they feel under challenge as a result of these kinds of decisions, but I think the potential and ambition still exists within the sector, but even that will now start to dissipate because of a lack of confidence and exhaustion about how people can move forward confidently into the future. There are long lead-in times for a lot of work in the cultural sector. And I do think people are growing impatient to see the gap closed between the potential that exists and the ambition that exists, and the reality of what is delivered and what could be achieved with just a little bit more in terms of the resource equation. I do think the way in which structures are in place of managing the business of government, and this includes local government, who are an important player in this equation as well in terms of resource, and they too are in decline in their support. The way in which structures drive siloed-based approaches to decision-making is missing the opportunity to think differently and behave differently in relation to culture, which can sit in a silo and does currently, but is clearly speaking to the wider policy agenda on, I keep mentioning health and education, for example. And so I think there's still a lot more work to be done to, yes, ensure that there's a strong culture budget in place, but also that we're working to unlock the opportunities across governmental portfolios for the added benefits and value that flows there as well.
My last question, we've heard last week there's been a 40% reduction in funding to local government at UK level, which obviously is a consequential effect, a very similar effect in Scotland, because if UK government cuts, it's also interesting to note that at no point in my memory in the last 13 years has there been an amendment proposed to the Scottish Government's budget by any other party asking for more funding for the sector. I just wonder, how would you describe, given, and we'll hear from the Cabinet Secretary next week, how would you describe your relationship with the Scottish Government just now?
I would say it's positive, but testing. The reality of what we're dealing with, I think we've been able to develop a very honest relationship, a very direct relationship where we can speak truths to each other. But it is clearly being tested. We are an arm's length body of government, but very much aligned to delivery of Scottish Government policy. And we take that job and responsibility very, very clearly and very seriously. But I do think that relationships are being tested, and I'm sure the nature of the relationships that we've got will enable us to navigate this, because it's vitally important that Creative Scotland has a positive, productive relationship as far as it reasonably can with the Scottish Government, to make sure that we can navigate what I know are public sector-wide challenges, and culture is not immune from that. This is not a special pleading, as it were. This is absolutely about recognising the positive contribution and value that culture and creativity make to the country in all dimensions, and ensuring that we've got the conditions in place to unlock that opportunity to maximum effect.
So I guess one last quick question to see. Trying to view it from a member of the public's point of view, if you have a situation where for 13 years you've had cuts of the global budget, and as you said, you can't take this in isolation, you've got to get the context. So if you've had cuts because of austerity for 13 years, and like you say, that's a cumulative effect, it wears people down over a period of time, do you think the public would be surprised to find that it would take until, say, year 13, and I'm not sure this is the case, and you can tell me if it's not, to think about starting to use reserves to address some of those issues? I realise reserves can be held for different purposes and a rainy day. Do you not think after 13 years of austerity, a rainy day might have arrived by now? Just how the public might perceive that.
So our reserves position varies year on year. Sometimes we have no reserves. And the way National Lottery income works is that we can actually overcommit to enable us to have negative reserves. It's not a policy position that we adopt, but it's a technical point. What I would say is that the National Lottery income is intended and framed under the National Lottery Act to be additional to government funding, not a substitute for. So we need to be very clear that the reserves position is built for a specific purpose, not intended to substitute for what should otherwise be Scottish Government funding.
I wonder if I could ask a final question. Oh, sorry, Mark. Sorry. Excuse me, Mr. Ruskell.
Thank you very much. Ian, when you came to committee this time last year, you were obviously looking at that £6.6 million cut. And the impression I got from you at the time was that that wasn't going to make a massive difference to RFOs in this year. But the concern was really about the next year, the 24-25, and about whether those cuts were going to continue. Is that essentially still the case? Despite the chaotic situation you're now in with reinstatement and then you're having to dip into those reserves again, the issue here is really still about 24-25 budget and what the impact might be.
I'll answer this in two parts. So we are stabilising the situation to enable us to move through the next 6 months. There is uncertainty over 24-25, which I'll come to in a second. But even under standstill funding, which is what this reinstatement from reserves of the £6.6 million enables us to achieve, as per our submission, means that we still see sufficient fragility in the sector that, in our estimate, currently at least a third of the current regularly funded organisations are so financially fragile as to be at risk in this next 6 month period. And so in our submission we've referred to that, and it's we'd have a consequential effect of around 900 jobs, 12,000 artists, employment opportunities, and the loss for audience, loss of audiences of 1.4 million. So that's even on a standstill basis. The problem has not gone away. It will be amplified if the reductions continue into next year, where if the 6.6 million wasn't available and was applied, the numbers go up enormously. So the estimate is that, based on current information and financial information and the fragility that we understand, around half of the current regularly funded organisations would be at risk. That would lead to 2,000 job losses. It would lead to 26,000 lost opportunities for artists' employment. And it would see nearly 3.5 million of lost audiences as a result. So in-year is not solved. We've stabilised it, but the fragility continues. Because in material terms, standstill still represents a cut. And that standstill budget is actually the number that was set 5 years ago. So, you know, the inflationary effects over that period were accumulating anyway, but they've been exacerbated in the current economic and fiscal environment.
Okay. Also had a couple of questions for Isabel as well. So I'm wondering, from the Screen Scotland point of view, how any kind of in-year budget revisions have impacted your work. And then separate to that, or perhaps linked into it in some ways, you have a memorandum of understanding with a range of partner organisations, including Scottish Enterprise. I'm just wondering how that process works. Is that effective? Are there opportunities to see perhaps more direct funding of Screen Scotland within that?
Thank you and good morning. Thank you for your questions. So on the first point, the position for this year's budget with Screen Scotland on the Scottish Government side is that we have £2 million of our in-year budget that is unresolved at this point, so we don't yet know whether or not that cut will be coming. And obviously that comes off the back of a £2 million cut last year. If I can draw your mind back to August, when we were able to announce really stunning figures of growth from 2021, going from 2019 to 2021, which represented the period when we were able to grow Scotland's infrastructure in studio terms and therefore draw in large-scale productions, be that high-end TV, be that film, and at the same time grow our own skills base and our infrastructural base. So we've proven happily quite what can be done when you have a proactive agency that has funding that can go into the right way. And I would say that that was funding that was drawn directly from the Scottish Government into Screen Scotland as part of Creative Scotland. And certainly Creative Scotland's role in building the infrastructure is absolutely critical. In terms of this year's budgets, the unresolution is unhelpful for all of the reasons that would be true of the cultural sector. In the main, confidence, planning are two absolute fundamentals for the film and TV production business. There is a long trajectory in terms of planning, and it is incumbent upon any agency, any country with its services when it's trying to attract production, that it can show that it is steadfast as a partner in a world where all sorts of other contingencies will come into that production process. It's an absolute fundamental. So in terms of how we go forward, we are obviously awaiting further news, but there's no way around the fact that it will mitigate our growth trajectory if we are unable to put that money into where it was intended to go, which is production, skills, talent development, all of those good things. On the second point, with regard to the MOU, when I first started at Screen Scotland, when it was born 5 years ago, the arrangements with the enterprise agencies were formalised into MOUs, and we still retain a strong relationship, but we do not work under an MOU basis with Scottish Enterprise anymore. I think it's fair to say that Screen Scotland has established itself as the agency in its own right, and we have worked out over time that we're better off working with our partners such as Skills Development Scotland, Scottish Funding Council and Scottish Enterprise on a more bilateral basis, and in some aspects that's been pretty productive, I would say. So we continue to co-fund business development support, and we work together on studio projects, I guess, as well. So in terms of where other budgets might be found, it's a good question. It's not the case at the moment.
Case then that it's those are agencies that maintain and hold those budgets that you then have to apply to, or do those budgets come straight to Screen Scotland?
There's no money that transfers from Scottish Enterprise or the other agencies. I mean, I guess I would single out Highlands and Islands Enterprise as being a really strong partner for us, where we co-fund projects that are obviously of mutual benefit. And South of Scotland Enterprise is actually coming forward quite strongly with good local partnerships, but there's no transfer of cash.
Thank you.
Ms. Forbes.
Thanks. Another question building on Mark Ruskell's question to Isabel Davis. I mean, I suppose for as long as we have a stagnating economy, high inflation, and a budget that's based on consequentials driven by austerity, things are going to be tight. And yet the screen sector has been such a significant contributor to economic growth in Scotland. And looking at some of these figures in terms of total spend up 55% since 2019, staffing up 39%. I mean, in terms of economic drivers, screen is at the forefront. And I wondered if, in that vein, you could just outline a few of the opportunities you see in the coming year. And of course, the link there to budget is if you grow, the budget will indirectly grow as well.
Thank you for that question. Absolutely. I think that leverage effect is true through production. So I think the opportunity that is coming back on us, and I wouldn't have felt confident to have said this even 2 days ago, but the resolution of the Writers Guild of America strike situation has immediately brought back a number of projects into our orbit. Clearly the Screen Actors Guild dispute is still ongoing, but we are more confident than we've been for a while that come January, production will be flowing again. And if we are not ready with the tools to attract that production to Scotland, then there's no possibility of it coming. It will come if we are able to attract it in with a range of production incentive, a readiness in our crew base, and of course the way in which we grow Scotland's opportunities further, the way we were able to see that huge leap in terms of jobs growth and production growth was to do with the skills programmes that are appended to productions. There's no better way to learn your skill set if you're working in production than on an actual production. And so the earlier that we can get in with those productions to work with them, and actually I must say the film and TV production sector is extremely ready to work on skills programmes if they have the time and the bandwidth to do so. And that's again where Screen Scotland plays a really proactive role. So does that answer your question around, the opportunity is there? And I just would say, Ian alluded to this earlier, in the cultural sector, but the fact that we have such a strong leverage effect, we work on a budget across grant and aid and lottery of less than 20 million. If you see, that we were worth over 600 million, nearly 650 million pounds in 2021 alone, and we're on that growth curve upwards, we've seen more studios come into play. Obviously, the reverse is true as well. If we're not able to draw that investment in, then those numbers won't even stay where they are. So, thank you.
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to add something because the screen sector is an undoubted success and on a success trajectory. There is a question mark over an aspect of the budget which could risk inhibiting that success trajectory, but nonetheless, it is undoubtedly there. What I wanted to add was actually my reflections on screen as an example of what is possible when you get the right factors in place. And those factors would be the right people with the skills, talent and expertise to unlock the opportunity. It's illustrated with Isabel and her colleagues in screen, but right across the staff body of Creative Scotland we have such people. So it's a combination of people with a very clear policy backing, a policy priority that has political backing, that then translates in combination with the unlocking of modest financial investment. And for the Scottish Government, that's less than £10 million. I forgive me, in addition to the 10 million from the National Lottery funds that we channel. So I think if you get the set of factors in place working together, you would, as we have seen on screen, you would be able to replicate that right across the cultural spectrum. And the return on investment would be equally as powerful, not just economically, but culturally and socially. So it's my point about modest investment actually can unlock the greatest potential and return on that investment.
Thank you. And I echo Ms. Forbes' comments about the success of the screen industry, something that we're all very, very proud of. I'm also conscious that a lot of the work we're getting back from cultural organisations, from Edinburgh festivals, from the Fringe and everything else, is that they've been successful. Post-COVID recovery is kicking in. We're seeing numbers returning and the sector flourishing. So, it's good to see performance across all areas in that respect. I wonder if I could ask, returning to the immediate challenges, obviously you've been able to mitigate with regularly funded organisations for this year. Next year we don't, do you know, have you had any indication from the government if that's going to be a recurring cut that we can see going forward? Has there been any discussions along those areas? And what impact would that if that cut continues, will it fall mainly on the regular funded organisations, or will you have to reevaluate your whole programme and ambition for multi-year funding, for instance?
So, two parts to that. On what our understanding is for next year, I think there is an indication from the Scottish Government that they would not wish to see this repeated next year, but of course, there is due process to be undertaken in relation to the budget planning and budget setting process through the Parliament. So it's undetermined, but I think there would be a desire for it not to continue, but it's not guaranteed. And sorry, forgive me, the second part was...
So going forward, will you be able to meet your ambitions for multi-year funding and the changes in business model that you would look at?
So if it's the same 6.6 million in the way that it's applied to our budgets, it would be directly a consequence of a reduction to the RFOs.
Yep. Beg Mr. Cameron in.
Thank you. Just on the subject of multi-year funding, I mean, I read with very great interest your submission about how you're setting up this system of multi-year funding. And you know, we hear it so often in this committee. But in terms of your funding, would you still prefer a multi-year funding settlement from the Scottish Government? Is that something that you have an ambition for, to allow you to likewise carry out your own system of multi-year funding?
Yes, is the short and direct answer. I think I'll go back to planning confidence again. The way the budget cycles have been working, it's 3 months' notice before the year end to understand the draft budget. And we know why that is a kind of chain of events from UK Westminster Parliament settlement to Scotland and so on. But it does make planning very last minute and precarious, because we need to translate that very quickly into confidence for the sector in the subsequent year. So the more, whatever the level of settlement, of budget settlement, the more we have on a long-term view, the better. I would also add, actually, we have Audit Scotland are our external auditors, and for all public bodies, this is the same. They have an expectation of us for long-term financial planning. And we have this conversation every year about our ability to meaningfully do that in a context of annual budget setting cycles in the way that they currently are undertaken.
Thank you.
Mr. Ruskell.
To ask then, what do Audit Scotland say about your reserves? Have they offered you any kind of guidance or analysis about the level of reserves that you have?
In general terms, I mean, it's understood that this is a position that we can adopt, hold. They know that we are prudent in how we use our income and think about reserves and the purposes for which we've got them. So it's all appropriate and in line with the Audit Scotland requirements and the finance manual. Yeah.
Okay.
Just to add to that, apologies, I think what would be a concern is if there was an expectation that when reserves are depleted, that there was any move to see National Lottery income stream, which is a third of our overall budget, then stepping in on an annual basis to compensate for to offset a reduction in Scottish Government income. There would be a concern then.
Yeah, Mr. Bibby.
I mean, just on the issue of the reserves, using the reserves this year will that make it more difficult to move to multi-year funding without having that cushion you otherwise would have had?
Yes, it's going to limit our ability to smooth the transition through multi-year funding because, as I've mentioned, the demand equation that was referred to also, an intention to apply from over 500 organisations requesting for that one programme alone, over £113 million a year. If those sort of numbers to be possible, then it's less of a challenge. But on the basis that current resourcing levels would see us nowhere near being able to support that level, we're going to see, even under current arrangements, fewer organisations supported. Those that we do support, we want to support an appropriate level to enable them to deliver the best outcomes. But I think unless something significantly changes for the better, we'll be funding fewer, and that means we need to give them time and space to think about what their future looks like, and that's what the transition support from reserves is intended to enable. But the less reserves we've got, the less possible it is to give people the time and space to understand whether it's reconfiguring the business into a different business model, or indeed for some it might be the closure, the managed closure.
I mean, it's a difficult situation. I mean, you're looking for people looking for certainty over multi-years. They're not even got certainty over 7 months at the moment, do they? So I've not a feel the situation here.
Any final thoughts, Mr. Pernod?
Yeah, just one further point on the demand around multi-year, and I'll also talk about demand on open funds as well, National Lottery open funds. On multi-year, I think we're all challenged by the scale of that potential ask, and our deadline for the first stage of the multi-year application process is at the end of October. So we'll know absolutely then and be clear about what the scale of that looks like. It will be an undoubted challenge, is what we expect based on the intentions to apply. But I think what we should look is at the other side of that coin. I think the ambition that will be inherent in all of those applications is going to be untapped if the resource levels aren't higher. So there'll be a big missed opportunity in terms of what could be achieved through support on that multi-year fund. It is only one avenue of support. It's the most significant one for many and most organisations in the cultural sector. But what we're also seeing is an upturn in the volume of demand on our National Lottery open funds. So these are entirely National Lottery supported programmes for individual artists and creative people and cultural organisations. The demand equation has gone up. It was already challenging, but the demand has gone up already by over 50% in terms of the number of applications that are coming in, and the financial ask because of the inflationary environment and the contraction of financial support elsewhere. The financial ask through those applications has more than doubled. The budget position is not any better. In fact, could obviously get worse. So the volume of unsuccessful applications that we're having to deal with is increasing, I'm afraid. So on all our budget fronts, National Lottery, Scottish Government and all our funding programmes, the demand equation has gone up to such an order now that we're thinking very carefully about how we can continue to make a meaningful offer whilst trying to manage the expectations of our ability to support that demand.
Yep. Ms. Davis.
Thank you. Just one final comment. We're very happy to talk about the success of the production sector. Obviously, other parts of the screen sector do have other challenges, but I just wanted to make one more positive comment about the way in which the Edinburgh festivals have, I think, been emblematic of the need to think differently and work together and be collegiate. So just publicly like to thank Fran Hedgie, who I know is on next, for her umbrellaing of the film festival in its time of need in August, but also the wonderful attitude that Festivals Edinburgh have had towards that festival, and indeed the Fringe Society have really lent into what we see as the opportunity to build an audience for Fringe work from the film and TV sector. So I just would like to say that there are some really great examples of people thinking differently and thinking collegiately across the board.
That's helpful. Thank you. I think we've exhausted questions this morning. I'm going to suspend briefly while we change over to our next panel, which will be cultural organisations to look at the budget scrutiny again. Thank you. A warm welcome back to our second evidence session this morning. Today we're joined by Laurie Anderson, Director of Culture Counts, Julie Amour, Director of Festivals Edinburgh, David Watt, Chief Executive of Culture and Business Scotland, Chris Bruard, Director of the National Museums of Scotland, Brenna Hobson, Executive Director of the National Theatre of Scotland, and Francesca Heggie, Chief Executive of Edinburgh International Festival. And a warm welcome to you all. Last year, our budget scrutiny coined the term perfect storm facing the cultural sector. I was just wondering if I could ask each of the witnesses to reflect on where they are now. I think most of you saw the evidence session previously with Creative Scotland, but I'll go around the room left to right, so if we could start with you, Julia.
No, I don't need to touch it. Sorry, don't touch the equipment. My apologies. Hello, hi. Thank you so much for inviting us this morning and for everybody's kind words about Edinburgh's festivals in 2023. And I think we were very buoyed up by the fact that it was a strong recovery in terms of audience experience and critical reception. But I would have to immediately say that from watching last week's session, I heard you refer to the term donut funding, convener. And I think that the real danger with that kind of outward success is that people do not realise that, under the waterline, the ship is hulled. And I think all of the issues that you heard about last week and the issues that you've heard this morning from the National Arts Development Agency are causing that precipice to loom ever closer for the festivals, despite doing a magnificent job. And it's all the people that make the festivals happen, the other people around this table and not around this table, who are independent artists, for example, who are gaining income through the festivals, using it as part of their juggling their livelihoods, and then working in their own communities across the whole of Scotland around the rest of the year. So obviously we are cultural organisations, and we may spend quite a lot of time speaking about the organisational challenges, but it's always with that motivation of how can we actually sustain a viable cultural system in Scotland, which is 70% freelance. So I guess I would say you've heard that the cards are going to fall, the system is going to fall. Is Scottish Government just going to let the cards fall where they will, or are they going to build for the future? And that, I think, even if you see us as coming at the bottom of the European League tables in future years, that is something that I think there is a responsibility to manage and to support the restructuring of with a multi-year targeted investment. I think that the Scottish Government is making choices despite the difficult situation. And recently we've seen some of the major events that have been supported overrunning in terms of their budget and that having to be supported. We've seen a commitment in the programme for government to future major events. This is not a sports versus culture thing. This is not an Edinburgh versus Glasgow thing. This is about evidence-based policy. The economic impact assessment that Festivals Edinburgh published in July showed that the perennial value of homegrown events is bringing back 10 times the amount of value that the Commonwealth Games was able to bring back in economic assessment terms. That is far from all the value of culture. But, when are the very supportive words going to be backed up by the deeds that this evidence would suggest are needed?
Thank you. Laurie.
Firstly, thank you very much for inviting us along to give evidence this morning. So you're inviting us to respond to the perfect storm that was reported on last year. I think at best, the sector would suggest that things have remained the same, but the reality for most is that things have got much, much worse. You took a lot of evidence last week about those particular individual factors that are contributing to that. The economic picture, as you know, is extremely challenging. The sector is suffering from the effects of high inflation, rising interest rates, fuel costs, cost of living. The impacts of Brexit are still having a significant impact on the sector. we're still in recovery, despite hearing some good news around festivals and recovery in certain areas. Audience numbers in many areas are still not yet at pre-pandemic levels. But it is this impact of the cost of living crisis and the standstill investment which is having the biggest impact on the sector. In terms of the culture portfolio, that's a real terms cut for the sector, and we cannot get away from the impact of that. What we're seeing is the reduction in cultural services. We're seeing staff losses. We're seeing challenges around retaining staff and about attracting new staff into the sector. There's a significant toll on morale and on the sector in terms of mental health. There are real threats of closures coming up now and loss of services. And the sector really is quite exhausted in terms of its ability to continue to make cuts and to diversify its income generation. As we've heard earlier, financial reserves across the sector are being depleted, and really the sector does remain in crisis. Looking ahead to 2024-25, we cannot begin to even imagine what that's going to look like, particularly given the news that we received yesterday with the cut to Greater Scotland. I think it's worth noting that at local authority level, things are particularly challenging. Over the last year, I know that 50% of Culture and Leisure Trust, which were members of Community Leisure UK, have received flat management fees in terms of the operation of cultural services. And we know that there's a trajectory now in terms of zero funding. And at least five of their members are reporting that they're on the brink of that at the moment. So the picture in terms of the perfect storm is not great. It's worse, much worse. Would you like comments just now on what we've heard earlier from Creative Scotland, or will we come back to that?
Perhaps we'll come back to that. We'll let introductory questions, but we'll come back to you, Laurie. Thank you. David.
Thank you for inviting me to speak as well. I suppose building on what colleagues have said, I would agree. The key issue for the sector is definitely talent drain, which has obviously been caused by these kind of aforementioned societal challenges. And many organisations are struggling to recruit both short-term freelance staff and core staff. For example, a major skills shortage in technical staff, and I'm sure Julia could probably speak more about that in terms of the festivals. And that's obviously a key contributor to that is Brexit, with the restrictions limiting access to the EU marketplace and the introduction of the bilateral work visas, etc., which is both costly and time-consuming, particularly for small-scale organisations. In addition, organisations are struggling to replace expertise in development roles, such as fundraising and business development, which is obviously significantly impacting their ability to secure additional income and look at new business models, etc. And this is obviously compounded by the fact that the reserves are being eroded, partly because of the impact of the lockdown and obviously the continuing cost of living crisis and the high energy bills, which is, you know, really crippling many organisations. In fact, South of Scotland Enterprise confirmed that some of the culture organisations in their constituency have seen energy bills increase by 400%, which is just simply not sustainable if we're looking at budget cuts again. So in summary, I think real-term reduction in public funding within that kind of context of external society economic challenges means that organisations can only continue to firefight to meet short-term challenges, and there's just absolutely no opportunity to look at growth and development for future kind of sustainability and planning. And if the budget pattern continues, there's going to inevitably be shrinkage, significant shrinkage in the culture sector.
Thank you. Brenna.
I'm sorry not to be able to paint a brighter picture. What I would say is that audiences are starting to come back. They're not the whole way back, but I think what we're seeing is that the demand is really there. Costs are very high. Costs are rising. We all know that. And you heard about a perfect storm last year, and we've seen some of the effects of that this year. We've seen Dancebase having to cut back on services, cut back on staffing. We've seen the loss of Film House. And I suppose the other point that I would make is that as a sector, we're incredibly interconnected. Technicians who work in theatre also work on film. Performers who work in theatre also work on film. If we erode the sector, whether that's national performing organisations, whether that's Creative Scotland-funded companies, that that impacts our ability to deliver in those real growth areas that can be incredibly financially beneficial to Scotland. And we are at the point where there's real danger there. We've got significant issues around skills and we risk losing people, generally speaking, to London.
Okay. Can I just clarify, Brenna? You say that, when you're talking about the technicians and the people that support the production, is it that they've been lost to the screen sector or they've just been lost to the...
No, not at all. One of the great joys of our industry is that people work between screen, between theatre, between music. That is a really healthy thing. And to have a healthy sector, we need to have screen, performing arts, all of those areas being well funded so that those freelance workers can work between the sectors and to have a viable career.
And Chris, thanks.
Thank you very much for inviting me. I want to start on a positive as well, because above the surface, the museum and gallery sector are doing wonderful, wonderful things. I was at the opening of the National Gallery's new galleries last night, Kilmartin, where a third of the collection there, we work with Kilmartin in terms of the National Collection, opened recently, and last year the Borough Collection. Extraordinary, extraordinary museum and galleries are really part of the beating heart of this country. But to go back to the perfect storm scenario and Julia's scenario of the hole below the hole, sorry for continuing an aquatic metaphor, I often feel like a swan gliding through waters, kicking desperately while the weeds grab around my legs. And beneath that surface picture, where visitors are returning, as Brenna says, there are real systemic problems that mid-year now present to the sector a huge challenge. And of course, all of those projects I've been talking about are the result of capital investment that goes back 10 years. I don't see that sort of glory of opening new spaces for another 10 years at least at the moment. It's a struggle for survival. Museum and galleries are at the core of what we do, and embedded in our act as National Museum Scotland, we preserve, we interpret, and we provide public access to extraordinary collections for Scotland's visitors and for the world, I have to say. And that's a legal obligation. And I'm very, very worried about that legacy for future generations because it's becoming frayed around the edges. So mid-year at the moment, just to give you a sense of how we're experiencing that, well, that systemic problem, our grant in aid has decreased really in real terms by 16% over the past 10 years. I think that echoes previous comments. We did get an uplift last year to reflect utilities and inflation costs, for which we were very grateful. Our visitors are returning. We feel like a thriving organisation. But mid-year this year, we face a deficit of 1.2 million if we're to match those costs that are not within our gift, really, particularly around pay in the future. And that will mean making some invidious decisions about what we do. And I think that's shared by the sector at large, the museum and galleries sector. With success comes a responsibility and comes future costs. So our visitors over the past 10 years have increased by 16% since 2011. The reinvigoration, the huge capital project for Chamber Street that took place has brought them back in crowds, much better than national museums in London. The international visitors have returned because we offer a fantastic programme. But our floorboards are getting worn down already. The displays are looking tired in those corners of the museum that we haven't been able to renew. And that, I think, unfortunately, is going to get worse. So, and I think I echo the comments of my colleagues around the table, that the effect there on morale, on keeping a workforce that is skilled,
and all of those other impacts on the broader tourist economy will reverberate out, I think. But positives, we have a lot to be proud of.
Thank you. Fran.
Thank you and good morning, and thank you for asking us to come along. I'll also start on a positive, and I think we've heard something about the positive way in which the festivals came back this year for the International Festival. We certainly saw audiences coming back, visitors coming back, and artistically and critically reviewed, it was one of our most successful festivals for a very long time. So I think the quality of the work is there, the skill of the people presenting the work and doing the work is there. But like other witnesses, there are things, you know, to worry about. We've talked a lot about a perfect storm, and I have to say I don't agree with that analogy. A storm is a one-off event. It gathers, it unleashes, and then it dissipates. What we're seeing in our case is 15 years of standstill funding, which has led to a 41% reduction in the value of public funding. That's not a storm, that's a climate. So we have seen climate change for the cultural sector in Scotland. And I have to say, at the moment, it feels like a pretty hostile climate that we're living in. It's not one in which we can even survive, let alone thrive. So I think what we are experiencing is a culmination and a coexistence of a series of circumstances that we know about, which relate to inflation, which relate to interest rates, that relate to the cost of living crisis that we're living through. But it's also a consequence of a series of choices that government has made over the last 15 years not to invest in culture. And I think what we're seeing, or some of this sort of difficulty that we're experiencing, is born out of something that Ian was talking about earlier on. We have a strategy that talks about enabling our sector to grow and to thrive and to recover. And then we have actions that are not consistent with that strategy. So both of those things can't be true. You can't have a strategy that says we're going to enable you to grow and then we're going to cut you in a year. So that thing's real. The cut has happened, it's real, which means that the strategy can't be real or the strategy can't be robust. So, and what that does is it leads to a gap in terms of credibility and a gap in terms of confidence, because that lack of confidence to enable us to plan or to enable our international partners to want to partner with us for future years to plan, that's gone. And so the impact of that is not just financial, it's not just planning. It's actually about reputation, and it's about credibility, and it's about Scotland's place in the world, because we are losing credibility and we have lost our international reputation for culture, because as an organisation we can't plan with our international partners 5 years hence, because we don't know what our financial situation is going to be in 12 months' time. So I think, you know, it's not lost that this the remit of this committee is external affairs and Europe, as well as culture. And I'm not sure that thought experiment has been done, or at least there's a degree of inconsistency there around actions that are taken in a policy sense around culture and the rhetoric around culture and the impact that that has on Scotland's reputation around the world.
Okay. Thank you for the opening remarks. This is going to be a round table, sort of free-flowing event, so I already know there's members coming in, but if I could go to a question from Mr Cameron first. I've got Mr Bibby as well.
Thank you, and I'm very glad, Fran, that you made that point about the committee's remit, which, as you say, includes external affairs, and obviously one area in which the Scottish Government promotes Scotland internationally is around culture. And I just was keen to explore the sort of international element a bit more, because you are, I think, all organisations that have not only a Scottish presence and profile, but a very impressive international presence and profile. So I just wonder if I could explore the kind of international element with any of the panel here who want to come in on the sort of the impact of funding on their international reach beyond what Fran has said.
Brenna?
So National Theatre of Scotland, along with the other national performing companies, proudly have a remit to represent Scotland internationally as well as within Scotland and to reach all of Scotland. You can tell by my accent that I'm a new Scot myself. When I first was approached about potentially coming over here, I'd seen six National Theatre of Scotland productions outside of Scotland. We are still proudly touring. We've got a show, Claire Cunningham's Thank You Very Much, in Europe in the coming weeks. We've been in the States this year, but it gets harder and harder. I know that all of my national performing colleagues as well are having to say no to some tours because we can't support them. We used to be able to invest in touring internationally. We're now having to make that break even. And we're in an international marketplace where governments who support their country's work, and this was highlighted in Fran's submission, those countries are much more active internationally. So we see that, you know, we're being outstripped by Canada, by Korea, the list goes on. So we're still proudly doing it as much as we can, but it is reducing.
Fran, did you want to come in? Thanks.
Yeah, should I come back a little bit more? I think obviously the purpose of the International Festival is to be international. We were set up after World War II to be a tool for cultural diplomacy through arts and culture to bring different cultures together. And obviously that role and that remit is still extraordinarily relevant. I think performing at the International Festival is seen as a mark of achievement in an artist's career from wherever they come from around the world. And this year we presented 2,500 different artists from 50 different nations, a third of whom were Scottish. So it's that joyous coming together of international and Scottish. But I think that the role that the festival plays in terms of soft power and cultural diplomacy can't be understated. We welcomed something more than 20 different international government delegations this year that came to Edinburgh this August to experience what a festival city looks like. And I have to say that in the majority of cases, they were shocked at what they were finding, because the, you know, Chris's analogy of the swan, what we show on stage and what we present outwardly is one thing. The reality of what's happening behind the scenes is a very different thing. So they, I know, took away that the sector is in distress, and that's a message that has gone out from Scotland to the world. So that's not a great thing. And I'll just give you a sort of an example of what that looks like. Recently, I had a text from a colleague, a counterpart in a European festival who does a similar job to me, and they were so worried about the conversations we'd had over the summer about the future of where all of this was going. They said, is there a way that we and a number of other European festivals can put together an aid package for you? Because that, you know, that's the sort of scale of the crisis that we're looking at. Now, what sort of message does that send out to our counterparts in Europe when they're thinking that we are deserving of aid? It's a really worrying external message that I'm not sure we want to be putting out, but that is the reality of the reputational damage that's happening through the lack of investment in culture.
Chris, you wanted to come in.
Like many museums and galleries in Scotland, we're a world-class museum, and we have a collection that's international in its reach and a number of partnerships. At the moment, we have a wonderful small exhibition on Rising Tide about the challenge of climate change in Oceania and creative responses to that, so working with partners and First Nation communities in that part of the world is incredibly important to us and incredibly important to our mission, as it is with many museums. One of the challenges, I think, is that we can only do that great work, international work and international reach, if the core funding is there to support it. If it's not, then it becomes a sort of added value and an extra. I don't think it is an added value and an extra. I think it's fundamental to the work that museums and galleries do in order to both remain competitive, but also to be true to their mission and their vision. So international work is a key aspect of what we do as a sector. Some of the challenges we might want to think about as well are, you know, I've mentioned rising tide, the drive to net zero, for example, which is also fundamental to us. So understanding how we can work towards what might be seen to be an opposition there is important. Cost and value is important. I'm not sure what it's like for the performing companies, but it used to be thought that blockbuster exhibitions that travel around the world were the sort of engine of income generation. They're incredibly expensive and complex to put together, and actually the profit margins are not so much that they can make a difference. So I don't think international work should be seen as an answer to some of the gaps we have in funding. I do think that international connection, inward international connection, also remains important to us. So international visitors in particular, who enjoy our collections and enjoy our experiences, we want to continue to attract, and we want to have a thriving international visitor experience across our sites and across museums and galleries.
Julia.
Yeah.
After Julia. Yeah.
Okay. I was going to pick up on that point about internationalism with a net zero trajectory. I think that's one of the things that we've worked really hard over the last 5 years, especially using some of the techniques that we learnt during the COVID lockdowns to reimagine what that's like. And what I think one of the reasons that the industry and international governments came back so strongly this summer to Edinburgh is that it's a global convention of ideas and debate on the northwest edge of Europe, and that we all benefit from that here in Scotland. We've always been an open society that needed to look to the world for our thriving, and we are happily in the position where people want to come and have that discussion here and meet with our society and exchange those ideas. But we know we need to do it in a more net zero way. So some of the techniques that everyone's been developing include longer term residencies, concept touring, where many companies, like one of our leading children's theatre companies, Catherine Wheels, is an absolute expert in taking the idea and training people on the other side of the world to deliver the same kind of work. Virtual planning of productions, so there's not as much mobility, and more engagement across the whole country, because these kinds of techniques can enable people like Deveron Arts in Huntly or the Wild Goose Festival to become more involved in those interactions. You know, all of that is starting to flourish, but this cycle of planning for survival and having to replan for survival in year and not having that long-term view of where we're going is very damaging to the possibility for us to continue that very unique position within the world.
Okay. David, did you want to go?
Thank you. I'd like to talk a little bit about the soft power of culture as a driver for international trade development. Currently, we run a programme called the Culture and Business Fund, which Scottish Government provides the budget for, and it can only support cultural and business collaborations that deliver cultural activities for the people of Scotland in Scotland, and it doesn't have a mandate to incentivise business investment in cultural exports, such as international touring or residencies or participation at festivals, etc. So the potential to develop an international component of that fund would really help to incentivise business to utilise cultural engagement as a calling card for developing kind of trade activities, which obviously is another key target for the Scottish Government. The issue is that within that, not only is the fact that the fund doesn't have an international remit, the fund was also cut by a third in the last financial year by the government, so we're not even able to kind of deliver cultural experiences for the full list of applicants that have actually applying to the fund in order to be able to deliver activities in Scotland. And one of the kind of challenges with that is that as much as the outcomes and the values and return on investment for business are broad, the funding from Scottish Government comes from the Culture Division, and it doesn't come from a cross-portfolio approach when it's delivering on the economy and society as well. So there need to be considerations on how those types of initiatives are funded and how they deliver against cross-portfolio agendas.
Thank you. Laurie, we haven't come to you. Did you want to come in on this point?
I'd just like to say that I would echo everything that colleagues have said. I'm not going to repeat all of those points, but there's no doubt that we have an excellent reputation in terms of our culture, both what we export and what we offer internally. It's the reason that international visitors come, because of our cultural sector. But there are significant challenges to working internationally, which some have picked up on, obviously to do with cost increases, but also barriers that are still prevalent due to Brexit are causing barriers for us to be able to deliver at the scale that we have done in the past. We did welcome the consultation around having an international cultural strategy this year, but there are concerns, and particularly now, about that level of ambition and the commitment to that and the funding that might be available to deliver that, because it needs resources to deliver at the level of ambition that we all want to achieve at.
Thank you. Donald, did you want
to come? I find those very full answers. Thank you.
Neil?
Thanks, Convener. I was actually going to raise the issue, ask the question that Donald asked, but I've got another question as well. I mean, I think the testimony there about the impact on international work is very, very important for us to hear. Domestically, I asked last week about the impact that funding pressures and the trajectory of funding would have on opportunities for children and young people in Scotland. And I just wanted to ask you if you had any reflections and thoughts on that, both educational opportunities, learning opportunities, but also employment opportunities as well. And notwithstanding, I know a lot of the great work that all the organisations here do to support opportunities for children and young people, just to get a reflection on what you think the challenges are in relation to that and how funding pressures could affect those, adversely affect.
Thank you. Since we're back on funding, Laurie, I'll come back to you with your earlier wish to comment on it.
So to comment on the cut?
As well as the question, yeah, around
okay.
funding. Yeah.
Well, I'll certainly deal with that first of all. So I think probably the first thing I might like to do is to quote the words of the First Minister in his speech when he launched the programme for government here a couple of weeks ago. The sector should be assured that this government values the role of culture, not just for the substantial economic impact it has, but also for the incredible joy that it brings people in Scotland and right around the world. So those were the words that were said in the chamber a few weeks ago. There are not many people within our sector that are feeling assured this morning. And my inbox is full of expressions of disbelief at the news of the cut to Creative Scotland. There are, we believe, 500 organisations in the midst of preparing funding applications to Creative Scotland who are going to be feeling incredibly confused and incredibly concerned about what lies ahead. Being on standstill funding over the last 10-15 years has been challenging enough. The sector lost faith in the government last year with the announcement of the 10% cut, despite the wealth of evidence that was provided to this committee and that this committee put forward about the challenges that it was facing. This faith was somewhat restored with the reversal of the cut, but that was after a major public campaign with it. As I understand, at least 15,000 members of the public spoke up about their views on the cut that was announced last year. Having it restored, I think, made the sector feel that it was being listened to and that it was under the challenges were understood. Yesterday's news, this morning's news that this cut's been reinstated, it goes beyond disappointing. It will be a massive knock in confidence to the sector, and there's going to be a significant job for the government to restore trust between the Scottish Government and the sector, in all honesty. It shows a disconnect between what's being said by us and what's being heard, and it ultimately shows that the value of the sector is really not understood. But this also goes beyond investment. It puts a question mark over the commitment to the ambitions that are being set out for the sector. We've just talked about the international cultural strategy. There's been a lot of work done to move culture forward and to think about its strategy, and we know that there are some challenges with that, as Franz mentioned, in terms of the revised action plan. But it's very difficult to see how this commitment can be taken positively forward with and how support for that level of ambition that's been set out can be supported with the news that we've received today. I do want to just touch slightly on, I suppose, a positive area where the government has stepped in for the sector, mainly because I want to urge its continuation, and that is around the support for the various tax reliefs, exhibition tax relief, energy bills, orchestra relief, theatre reliefs. All of these have been lifelines to the sector over the last few months, and have allowed certain organisations to continue to exist and to continue at a level of service because of those. And so we would urge that those dialogues continue to maintain those. But those alone are not going to be enough to rebalance the gap in investment. So that's what I would say in terms of this morning's news and how we would view it. I think in terms of children, young people, I think there's been talk this morning about those broader impacts in terms of the sector's role in contributing to health, to well-being, to young people, to education. We anticipate there's going to be challenges in developing the new careers within the sector, and we know that this is likely to lead to services and provision of that nature being cut when there has to be a focus on core services.
To give two examples of projects that support young people and families in our museums. This week is Maths Week, which is a wonderful opportunity for young people to come in and experience our collection through the prism of maths and to increase their numeracy. It's certainly increased my numeracy skills by engaging with Maths Week every day. It's funded by education, by Scottish Government every year. It's year-on-year funding, so we can't quite predict what will happen in the future year, but it's built a legacy and it's built a wonderful story, and it is a really good example of cross-portfolio working, that culture can and should be funded from other portfolios as much as from the culture budget. So I commend Maths Week, and I encourage you all to go to the activities as they are on and look at it as a model for different sorts of funding models for culture. Digital is also important in terms of the way that we reach school children across Scotland, and it's one of the ways that we pivoted during the lockdown and the pandemic years, that we were able to beam out into schools and use our collection digitally when people were learning at home. We now reach every local education authority in Scotland with those programmes, with the curriculum, which is a great thing, a really great thing. It does require investment in the digital on all sides, and my colleagues at Museum Galleries Scotland, for example, offer the example of those in the museum sector that are suffering from underfunding at the moment, using their own laptop staff in order to be able to deliver these sorts of programmes. That's a real risk in the future, a risk to digital security and a risk to the survival of these really creative opportunities. And I think one of the risks we carry is that education and education programmes, that everyday experience that children have in our museums and galleries, which is wonderful, we've all experienced it, you remember it for life, is often seen as an add-on. It's the kind of thing outside of the core that dissipates when funding is at risk, I think. So some great examples of the work we can do with children, but some thinking about legacy and how they are funded in the future.
Fran, do you want to come in?
Just building on some of Chris's points there, I think the evidence of the benefits that
arts and culture gives to wider social agendas in terms of health and well-being and education and community building is well made. That's there. And of course, there's a tension that all of those benefits are 100% reliant upon the core being able to exist and to happen. Because without that core, whether it's a museum exhibition or a festival or a theatre production, without that happening, there are no attendant benefits. So in order to enable those to continue and those benefits to be felt across society, you've got to fund the core bit. And I think what we have all seen is a retraction away from some of that, because the reality is that the work that we do in communities, the work that we do with schools, the work that we do to develop talent within the industry isn't revenue generating. So we are forced inevitably more towards activities that do bring in income, so that as organisations we are that little bit more resilient. So very sadly, we move away from those things that we care very, very deeply about. So an example of that is this year we weren't able to do the fireworks concert, which is something that is free, it's for the people of Edinburgh, it's fun, it's joyous, but it costs £750,000 to put on. And we haven't got that spare, we haven't got that sort of flexibility within the budget anymore. So inevitably, we retreat and retract into those things that we know can generate income, sell tickets, raise sponsorship against, and some of that incredibly valuable work that is an additional benefit falls by the wayside, and it's not what we want. It's the absolute opposite of what we want. But you can't have that work if you don't have the core. And I just another thing on that is the sort of displacement of energy and effort. At the moment, I probably spend 70% of my time on this question of how do we balance the books. And I'm not sure that's the best use of my time or all of our team's times in trying to solve that conundrum, where we could be thinking creatively, we could be thinking ambitiously, we could be thinking about how we support communities, we could be doing that. But at the moment, we are forced in a situation to be very internally focused. And I think the impact on that and the sort of the stresses that it brings to those people working in the sector, whether it's as a self-employed creative freelancer who are the lifeblood of this industry, or you're running a big organisation or a mid-sized organisation, is huge, because that's where the headspace is, that's where the energy is, that's where the effort is, because it's such a crisis point at the moment.
Okay, Julia, and then I'll come to Brenna.
I wanted to mention what has been a really positive example of how we've been able to increase our impact on young people through quite a marginal increase of investment by the Scottish Government and the City of Edinburgh Council and the festivals themselves through fundraising. So the leverage point about, you know, how much is additionally brought in when a long-term approach is taken. It was called the PLACE programme, Platforms for Creative Excellence, and it allowed us to have that planning confidence that Creative Scotland was talking about over 5 years. And this is between 2019 and 2023. Although it had to be confirmed every year, there was an agreement between the public funders that this was a commitment, and that was matched then by the donors, and we brought in over 66% more funding from the funding that Scottish Government put into it through that approach, and that allowed us to increase our schools engagements by 70%, our community engagements by 33%. And I asked, very unfortunately, it's coming, that commitment is coming to an end also this year. I asked one of our very faithful private donors if they would consider helping us to keep that going. And the answer was that they're not interested in becoming a funder of last resort if the government and the public funders pull out, but they are interested in a long-term strategic approach. So I think, you know, it's a really important learning point for us about how everybody needs to get round the table and have that strategy for the future, because actually our private donors will also start to fall out of the picture if we don't have that strategy.
Brenna.
We've all got programmes that we're incredibly proud of and incredibly committed to. For National Theatre of Scotland, we have a a programme called Theatre in Schools Scotland that we run with Imaginate, who are a Creative Scotland client, that reaches 16,000 school children in their schools every year with the theatrical offers, because we know that it's increasingly difficult for schools to get out, although excursions are incredibly important as well. But we've had to pick up more and more of the cost of that because it's so much harder for the smaller organisations. At some point, we will come under pressure with that as well, and everybody has an example like that. The other thing that I would say is that we're all really committed to innovating. We have an education portal, which we put recordings of our productions on. We put teaching resources on. We've got a deal with the various unions so that if it's for educational purposes, that that can be accessed for free. There are 432 drama teachers in Scotland. 700 teachers have signed up to this program because it's not just about drama, it's about English, it's across the curriculum. We know that this is valued. And seeing something online is not the same as seeing something in real life, but it helps. But again, all of these things are under pressure, and I think, you know, every single organisation you speak to could have an example like that.
David.
I'd like to raise the Scottish Government's advisory group on economic recovery, the Higgins Report, which recognises that culture's a significant contributor to social and economic recovery and renewal, and obviously recommends that the culture sector is a high priority because it's inherently innovative and entrepreneurial. The business sector, like the culture sector, has obviously been hit especially hard by the pandemic, Brexit, cost of living crisis, and there are immense trading challenges, but also staffing challenges, which of course we've already discussed in the culture sector. So there's never been a greater need for those sectors to kind of collaborate. And although the Higgins Report highlights opportunities for innovative solutions, that's not possible when both the business sector and the culture sector are in cost-cutting mode. And so again, further threats to budgets for the culture sector makes it very difficult to innovate if they're firefighting. And unfortunately, I think there's very little evidence that any initiatives have been put in place to realise the aspirations within the Higgins Report. With culture, I think, in the majority, not present or around the table when it comes to setting broader policy agendas. And I think that whole kind of cross-cutting issue of culture not having representation is a significant challenge for the sector and society going forward. I think that cutting culture budgets is only going to exacerbate that situation, and I've already referenced the fact that the Scottish Government cut the Culture and Business Fund budget, which incentivises business and culture sponsorship by a third last year, and I can't commit to a standstill budget for the current year. So we're looking at not just, main cultural kind of activity that is being potentially under threat, but incentive funding schemes that are trying to encourage cross-sector collaboration, which is surely the way we should be looking to going forward.
Mr. Bibby, did you want? I've got Ms. Forbes, and then Mr. Stewart, and then Mr. Ruskell, and then Mr. Brown. Sorry, everybody wants in, but I'll go with Kate first.
Thanks very much, and thanks for all you do to contribute to Scotland's culture. You may have heard my question in the previous session, which is that, of course, part of our budget challenges are to do with a stagnating economy, inflation, and a budget that has been largely shaped by austerity over the last 10 years. And we, of course, are very much focused on one side of the balance sheet in this conversation in terms of your costs. But there was some figures that jumped out at me in Creative Scotland's submission, which, if it's okay, I'll just read, that the increase in GVA of Scotland's creative industries has increased by 62% since 2010, and staffing has only increased by 9%. So fewer people are contributing enormously to Scotland's economy, which should be a cause for great celebration. And I had three questions, because I know there's a lot of people, so I thought I'd throw them all out at the same time, and you can pick and choose. One, do you feel like that economic contribution, which is enormous, is fully recognised when it comes to funding conversations, either in terms of public funding, private funding, or third sector funding? Secondly, how has the funding mix changed in your organisations in terms of the balance across those different sources? And my last question is, what are the funding opportunities in the coming year in terms of continuing that trajectory of contributing to Scotland's economic prosperity, which in turn raises the revenue to reinvest?
Looking to see who'd like to go first on that. David, can I force your hand?
Yeah, I'm just looking for something. opportunities. Well, opportunities I've already described as being a better and deeper engagement with communities and the business community, and thinking about the needs of those other sectors where we know that culture provides instrumental benefits as well as cultural value. We recently undertook a survey to ascertain what the appetite for culture and business collaboration was, which was born out of what we had seen happening during the pandemic, when we saw cultural organisations repurposing their assets when they weren't able to kind of perform to audiences, etc. So RSNO doing online percussion workshops for school kids when the schools were in lockdown, Scottish Ballet getting their dancers to do breathing and movement exercises for the NHS staff that were at the coalface of the pandemic. And a lot of that stuff was under the radar, because only the people that were supporters of those organisations recognised that that was a valuable kind of contribution. And so we did a survey of arts and heritage organisations and said, well, looking beyond the pandemic, what do you think are the opportunities to diversify income streams and to kind of look at, you know, aspirational development? And 195 organisations responded, and a lot of that was about how to better engage with business and what they could do for business in terms of the products and services that they might be able to provide. So a good example being Scottish Ballet repurposing their movement workshops to provide support for corporate supporters such as the employees of KPMG when they were in lockdown and working from home, so they would get up and move away from the computer and breathe properly, etc., because they weren't able to have the water cooler moment. And we then correspondingly, so the 195 cultural organisations, we then went back out to business, and 114 businesses came back and we said, right, this is what the culture sector says it can do. It can develop products and services, or it can hand tailor, not moving from their core purpose, but, you know, develop some certain aspects of what they do to provide some solutions for business, which we could be transactional and could bring new income streams to the sector. What are important to businesses? And both said that the challenge was access to markets, and the fact that they didn't know who to go to and when to go to them when they were looking for the cultural solutions to business challenges, etc. But what they said was, nine out of 10 businesses said that they saw that this culture sector was really important to engage with, but only 20% found it easy to do so. And 96% of the culture sector said that they were actively seeking business engagement and transactional relationships with business, but only 17% found it easy to do. So there's a kind of a clear kind of potential supply and demand situation there that needs some kind of brokerage in the middle. The rationale for the businesses who were interested in some kind of marketplace was to achieve certain kind of business targets, a lot of which were internal, which were about staff and health and well-being. 73% of the respondents saying that they would seriously consider engaging with a business if they could deliver activities to improve staff and health and well-being. 76% if they could engage with culture to support innovation, creative thinking and problem solving in the workplace. 70% to look at enhancing productivity in the workplace, and similar amounts and numbers in percentages for team building, improving dynamics, as well as, you know, greater engagement with communities. So there's a recognition within the business community that culture can deliver benefits from them, but there needs to be a greater understanding of that across government portfolios, and it can't all sit within the culture division because it's obviously addressing cross-portfolio kind of agendas.
Julia?
Yeah, thanks very much, David, because it's such a complex picture, the cultural economy and the creative economy, that you set out some of those interdependencies very well. And I think that's one of the reasons why the economic contribution of culture is not well recognised, is because it is quite difficult for policymakers to get their head around it, because it's micro businesses and SMEs, it's freelancers, And it's fragmented across the country. But I think some of the enterprise bodies across Scotland, particularly Highlands and Islands Enterprise and South of Scotland Enterprise, I think partly because of their remit from government, are able to more capitalise on the way that culture infuses benefits across our communities. You know, the role in placemaking, the role in helping quite fragile communities to thrive, the role in a more well-being economy approach where you're not just talking about monetary, but you're also talking about core economy services that are being provided. But to turn to the more monetary aspect of the overall national economy, on that change in the funding mix, Edinburgh's festivals on the average are about 15% funded by public sources, and the 85% that's self-generated is the two top sources are, of course, ticketing and commercial donor and sponsor income. That is a source of astonishment to many of our international peers, because their national level festivals are the other way around. They're maybe 80% state funded and 20% self-generated. So it's an extraordinary achievement already, and it's very interconnected into those other bits of the creative industries which are pulling away so much from the rest of the economy, because people who act as technicians in our sectors, who do a lot of the underlying kind of software design and so on, they're also working across gaming industry, music industry, all interdependent parts. And actually, Fran is the expert on this, because she just sat on a committee about this very thing over the last couple of years. So that has built up over decades, but it changed greatly after the financial crisis, because a big chunk of that for the Edinburgh Festivals was corporate donors. That's almost dropped away completely, and individual donors have now replaced that component, and the segment of individual donors has grown by over 200% in that time. But obviously it's much less stable, it's much less of a commitment from the whole business community of Scotland, and that's not good. And finally, I guess in terms of opportunities in the next 12 months, many of our festivals have been doing great work in the United States, activating the kind of diaspora interest, and I know that will be the case. I see nods elsewhere around the table. That's fantastic, but they are interested in commercial opportunities. So if you want a less dependent, if you want to use that word, culture sector in Scotland, we can go get those opportunities, but they are commercial opportunities. The other opportunity I'm working on is around the Edinburgh and South East Scotland local authorities coming together on a regional prosperity framework. And that provides us with an opportunity to link together Edinburgh festivals and organisations and individuals based around the other five local authorities to try and develop more of a regional tourism, cultural tourism economy. We're really excited about that, but that will take public investment.
I'll go to David and then Fran. Thanks.
But about the economic development agencies, I think Highlands and Islands Enterprise have kind of got a track record of working quite closely with the culture sector, and have actually invested in both capital and revenue in places like Comar and Tobar and Mull, and they proactively encourage and enable arts and heritage organisations to attend things like Expo North, which is great. South of Scotland Enterprise, you know, proactively work with and fund people like the Stove Network and Alchemy, Film and Arts, etc. So there's a recognition of the kind of the economic contribution that culture brings, particularly in those kind of slightly more kind of rural and regional areas. I think we've struggled to see a similar understanding within Scottish Enterprise, and I think that has a possibly been because of kind of the change of leadership in the organisation. I think there was a lot of positive kind of response when Steve Slater came into the Enterprise Agency, and there was a kind of sense that culture was going to become more of a kind of a mainstream player within it. But since he's left, it seems to have dissipated again. So we'd like to see how there's a kind of a consistent national kind of approach within the economic development agencies to the understanding of the value that culture brings.
Fran?
Yes, thank you. I might pick up on some of that. I think
culture as part of the creative industries is absolutely fundamental and foundational. We know that the creative industries are growing at 1.5 times the rate of the rest of the economy. So investment in creative industries, including culture, means that the whole economy grows. And there is there's a sort of a golden thread from the subsidised culture sector right the way through to the commercial sector, because it's the public investment in arts organisations and the creation of artwork that enables us to take the risk that commercial operators won't or can't take. So you take something like, you know, Warhorse or Matilda is the obvious, you know, the examples that are always used. They started in the subsidised end of the spectrum and then have then been commercialised and have brought huge benefits. So, but you've got to support that initial origin of the work in order that you can get the consequential economic benefits and economic benefits later on. I think there's an opportunity for greater joining up across government in this respect, because I sometimes fear there's a bit of a sort of silo mentality that happens, that culture is over here and economic development or trade or investment is over there and never the twain shall meet. And an example of that, I think, that is current is the investment that's coming from UK government and Scottish government jointly into investment zones. So there's £80 million coming into two different zones, Greater Glasgow and the North East, in both of those areas. And the creative industries, including culture, is one of the priority sectors that can benefit from those investment zones and be part of those bids. Now, in early conversations I had with culture ministers, they weren't aware of that ability to be part of those bids. So I don't know, you know, that may have changed now, and I really hope it has, and obviously those decisions are made locally. But I think greater joining up between the potential of the creative industries and culture to contribute to economic growth locally and nationally, I think there is definitely more work to be done there. And just to one of your other questions, the makeup of our sort of income. Whilst we have seen a 41% drop in public subsidy, at the same time our levels of philanthropy and corporate sponsorship have grown by 200%. So we have worked incredibly hard to backfill that gap. It doesn't make it up. In future years, if we stay even at standstill, let's not talk about cuts, but if we stay just at standstill, we have a deficit opening up of between £1.5 and £2.5 million a year. So that's the size of the gap that we're talking about. So, and Julia's completely right. I think the generosity and support of our donors and philanthropists in Scotland is extraordinary. But they will not subsidise government. What they want is to have a partnership and have that confidence that there is a long-term strategy there that they can support and play their part in. But that long-term thinking needs to be there and needs to be joined up for them to come in. And just one sort of other example of perhaps where there could be greater join-up and thinking is obviously there's the concern around the impact that alcohol has on the population and the desire to introduce some sort of restriction around alcohol advertising and sponsorship. I think the desire to address that problem is shared by everybody. One, I think, of the unintended consequences of that sort of legislation would be the disappearance of alcohol sponsorship within the arts and culture sector. And if that goes, then that's another plank, because we rely on that form of sponsorship hugely because of the nature of the entertainment industry that we also reside in. So just the joining up of and the thinking through of some of those implications of some of those policy decisions and movements would be really welcome.
Okay, very quickly I'll go through those three questions. My grasp of stats isn't great, as I said earlier, but there's some really interesting ones here in terms of the first one on both economic impact and value. We did some really useful research, quick research on spend, grant and aid spend per visitor across different nationals, across the nations of the UK. National Museum of Wales, £17.86 per visitor. National Museum of Northern Ireland, £15.36 per visitor. The England nationals, an average of £10.52 per visitor. Now, this is great news. National Museums of Scotland, if you read it one way, £7.97 spend per visitor in grant and aid, and we're delivering equal, I would say, if not better programming and experience than any other. So we drive real value for the funding that we receive from grant and aid. The last time we did a more detailed economic impact study of our museums, so that's National Museum of Rural Life and East Kilbride, the museums in Edinburgh, National War Museum, and the National Museum of Scotland, and the National Museum of Flight. Across the piece, just before the pandemic, we contributed £116.8 million to the economy, supported 5,190 jobs, 13% of tourism jobs in Edinburgh. And I think we've seen a rapid recovery post-pandemic as well. It would be an interesting exercise to run now. National Museum of Flight alone contributed £8.4 million to the economy and 390 jobs in East Lothian, 340 there. So that, again, is great news, I think, and a lot to build on. In terms of that mix between grant and aid and commercial, philanthropic and other sorts of funding, well, grant and aid accounts for 70% of our funding. I've been in Scotland for 13 years, best years of my career in terms of the institutions I've worked for. I came here from a London national at the time of the last financial crisis, when the proportion of grant and aid for the London nationals at that point went down to 30% of their total budget. So I commend Scottish Government for their continuing support of that 70%. It has meant we've been able to deliver that value above and beyond. One of the challenges is, of course, that the ecology, the funding ecology in London or New York or anywhere is very different to Scotland. So building up that extra 70% from high net individuals is perhaps more of a challenge where we are. So we have to think much more creatively in terms of those opportunities. I'm glad you talked about the alcohol sponsorship problem, because I can give you two examples where we've worked in incredibly creative partnerships with Glenmorangie and with William Grant. I think, like, talking about individual companies, but they've done such great things for us. William Grant, in order for us to be able to properly publish and catalogue our amazing world-class collection of tartan, we couldn't have done it without them in that partnership. It was added value on top of that core. Similarly, Glenmorangie, in terms of interest in early Scottish history, extraordinary work on Viking era archaeology and getting that out into communities. So more of those partnerships are important to us, and support for that work, going back to the international question that Julia and others have raised in terms of the potential of the Scottish diaspora, that high net worth issue. I'm off to New York in November, as many colleagues across the cultural sector are, to work with our American Foundation to build on that. But any support, help we can receive from Scottish Government, always gratefully received.
I know David wants to come back on, but I'm conscious some people have contributed. Does anyone else want to come in before a final thought? Brenna, yeah.
Thank you for acknowledging the value that culture brings financially as well as in other ways. Like colleagues, our investment from Scottish Government is going down as a percentage of turnover. Philanthropy, box office income, co-production income is going up. Now, that can be a really good thing. Our production of Burn with Alan Cummings in it last year was co-produced with a theatre in New York. very Scottish production. They invested in it. This year, Dracula, which is, rooted in Doric and is a co-production with Aberdeen Performing Arts, has also been invested in by Belgrade Theatre in Coventry. So those are really valuable things. But if we are also going to, as we must, village halls in Nairn, in Strathpeffer, if we're going to reach Mull, if we're going to go into schools and subsidise that really heavily, then that investment piece from Scottish Government is absolutely vital. And I would also echo that there are commercial opportunities, but having that foundation of Scottish Government investment and having that long term, because we as the other national performing companies are on annual funding, means that commercial investors will have confidence that we'll be around to deliver, and that at the moment is slightly sugary.
Okay. David, you're next.
I just want to come back onto the kind of sponsorship issue, because I think we focus quite a lot on big sponsorship here and you know, about the nationals, etc. But there's sponsorship activity happening all across the country that we see through the Culture and Business Fund, and we know that since 2017, the fund has match funded cultural activity and business sponsorship in all 32 local authority areas across the country. That's about £2.5 million worth of investment in 148 projects. Of that, about £1.4 million comes from business. So that means for every pound of Scottish Government money, business is investing £1.21 in match funding for business. So that's a pretty effective leverage of generating new investment in culture. Hence another concern that the fund has been cut by a third in the last year. But the issue for that is also, as I said, is about its small business. So things like the Festival of Small Halls and Sky, supported by a local hotel, it's sponsorship, but it's actually targeted marketing, because that hotel recognises that if they create a generation and they create a kind of cultural destination and a cultural activity, the hotel will be full, the restaurant will be full, the bar will be full. So it's investment in something which is actually good for the local community. So we need to look at enhancing the opportunity to do that. Or somewhere like the Stonehaven Folk Festival doing the similar kind of thing with local businesses. And a lot of those businesses are not the big nationals. It's the butcher, the baker and the candlestick maker who are investing kind of small scale, sometime in kind, which is bringing significant economic value through cultural tourism. And we need to look at that. And how is that funded by government going forward? And does that sit just within the Cultural Division budget? Or should that be cross-portfolio?
Kate, did you want to come back in?
Perhaps the various representatives share some of that data with the committee. And I also think commendations for passing the numeracy test during Maths Week.
Alexander.
Thank you very much, Convener. You've made it very clear today that the sector is in distress. I think we got that information last week and also from the previous guests we've had here today as well. The reputation of the organisations that you all represent are at risk and continue to be at risk. But you've all been extremely inherently innovative in what you've done to manage the crises that you find. Your sector have diversified its income, it's diversified its process to try and manage that. But there is still this mismatch between what all you are trying to do and what government are saying and doing. I asked last week about the working groups, the strategies, the action plans. I asked if you were being listened to, and I'm sure you are all listened to. Last week I was told by the groups that were being listened to. But you're being listened to with one hand tied behind your back. And after recent events, it would appear that both hands at the moment seem to be behind the back. So it's about trying to engage in how we go forward. We all want a long-term strategic approach. We know that sectors bring in over £5 billion a year with thousands of organisations and tens of thousands of people employed. They are all at risk if you are at risk. And at the moment, you are at risk of where you go for the future. So it's about how do you attempt as organisations to recruit development roles for the future and see that development? Because at the moment, you're stagnating and you're living from hand to mouth. So, but you all want to achieve, and you are all achieving what we punch above our weight. We get it, all of that. And each and every one of your organisations is doing that. But it's about the strategy that needs to be required. There needs to be much more cooperation, there needs understanding and respect, because without that respect of the culture sector, the confidence will continue to be eroded. And that confidence is being eroded every day at the moment. And I can see that, and you all feel that. So it's about, where do we take this long-term strategic approach? How do you develop that recruitment role and that development role to give yourself a chance for the future?
Okay. I'm looking to see if anyone wants to come in on that question. Laurie?
Yeah, thank you very much for that question. Absolutely, a sustainable funding model is what's needed. That's going to provide the investment levels to support the sustainability of the sector. And we need that on a multi-year basis. And these are things that this committee's called for and we've all been talking about. There have been lots of suggestions over the last few years about potential solutions for that. And to be honest, we haven't seen much progress in taking those things forward. One of the key things that we think, and has been mentioned today, is taking that cross-portfolio approach, or that whole systems approach, which I know was highlighted in the Culture and Communities report that was that you launched a couple of weeks ago. Work's already been being done across multiple areas, but we need to identify ways to access investment from a cross-portfolio basis that's beyond project funding. And it is that embedded understanding of the benefits of culture and where it's meeting those other portfolio priorities. There have been discussions about transient visitor levy and the potential of that, and there has been some progress made in that, but that's not yet something that has been launched. There have been discussions about a percentage for arts or a culture scheme. This was something that was a 2021 government manifesto commitment, but we haven't seen very much progress in that particular area either. And that would obviously see funding coming from government infrastructure projects. And there are other ways to be looking at it. There could potentially be flexibility for local authorities around changes to the Verity House Agreement. There are a number of different ways that we can look at making changes, but what's needed is a clear leadership and a commitment and an ambition and drive to actually want to find these solutions and take them forward.
Julia?
Yes. So that ambition to place culture at the heart of Scottish society has been reiterated in the literally dozens of speeches that Scottish ministers have made at Edinburgh's 2023 peak season festivals. And so we do feel that culture is appreciated by them, and we hear that. I think some of the things that would make that feel real is making progress with that cross-portfolio approach that Laurie was mentioning. There's a very interesting blog, which I'm sure you've all had access to, by Matt Baker from the Stove Network in Dumfries and Galloway, about the approach to funding professional and community sport, for example, and how a pot of funding hypothecated from across portfolios could be available to kind of really make that approach to culture contributing to those policies real. And we would like to see that combined with a set of shared high-level outcomes, because the other thing that Scotland suffers from is, you know, small scale. It's a benefit, it's very much a benefit. Our international peers come and say, that's wonderful, you can get your system in a room. I think it does make beautiful things happen. But at the same time, our counterparts down south are experiencing the kind of overheads Fran was talking about, managing their budgets. We're experiencing that more because a greater proportion of our human resource is dedicated to that. So if the public funders could be working around a shared series of high-level outcomes rather than all, you know, a very detailed series of individual key performance indicators, that would be a big contribution to us all thinking more strategically about this. There's 3 years until the next election. So if we're talking about a serious restructuring of Scottish culture, which everything that we've heard last week and this week suggests that we are, then we would like to see a multi-year commitment to that, even if that needs to be reconfirmed every year. And then finally, There are non-financial things, some of which have been touched on today, that can be done to reduce the costs of the culture sector operating and the kind of proofing of policy regulations so that we don't have unintended consequences coming forward. Obviously, alcohol regulation is one. Deposit return scheme, detailed workings are another, and particularly for Edinburgh, the short-term lets legislation, where, as you might know, the festivals collectively are looking for home sharing and home letting to come out of that agreement, not in any way disagreeing with the policy intent of better regulating that market. But those are three things that could make a significant difference.
Fran, you wanted to...
where we need to start. I think we need to take a step back and go, right, what is the ambition that we have for arts and culture in Scotland? And be similarly ambitious as we have been in other policy areas. This is a country that's got free NHS prescriptions. We've got free tuition fee for students. We've got free travel for the under 25s. Those are really bold and progressive, ambitious movements that we can do as a country. What's the equivalent for culture? So with the greatest of respect for all the work that's gone on to date, I would take the culture strategy and I'd put it on one side and I'd take out a blank piece of paper and I'd talk to everybody around the table and I'd talk to our artists and I would talk to our creative freelancers and I'd talk to our communities up and down the country and I'd talk to the people that run the organisations and go, what is that equivalent? Because it isn't taking the spend from 0.58 to 0.79. It isn't a bit of tinkering around visitor levy. These are all levers you can pull at the right time. But what we haven't got is that overarching ambition. And with that then comes, I think, probably a restructuring of some of the mechanics to make that happen, whether that's in sort of departmental terms or funding routes or mechanisms or the joining up between different parts of government that's necessary to ensure that coherence of the economy and social outcomes and creativity. But without that ambition, and I'm not sure we've got a clear sense or perhaps a common sense of what that ambition is. And I'd say that's where we need to start. So honestly, a culture strategy action report, I think our time is better spent on focusing on the ambition.
Does anyone else want to come in on that? I'm conscious of time. As we're moving on, I've got two more members to come in. But David, final thoughts on that?
I agree, and I think that should take into consideration some key kind of pillars of things that we need to think about. We need to look at cultural tourism and the importance of tourism, of culture to the tourism economy. And we need to better measure that and get a sense of the true value of that across the whole of the piece. And a lot of organisations that are contributing are too small and don't have the resources to do that on their own. So there's an opportunity to work more strategically with the economic development agencies there. Obviously, we spoke about them earlier. And try to make sure that culture's got a voice at that table when we're looking at national and local policies, particularly around food and drink, tourism, hospitality, etc., because it's disjointed at the moment. And we are a small country. We should be able to work more collegially. Infrastructure, we've already kind of touched on that. How much influence or how much of a voice did the culture sector have in the city and regional deals? Not very much from what I've heard. We need to rethink about how that voice is at the table. And we need to make sure that our development agencies like Creative Scotland and Historic Environment Scotland are invited as statutory consultees to all these kind of government infrastructure projects, which I know that they are not at the moment. And then we need to look at skills development. Well, I think we've already covered that. And also economic sustainability and look at how our cultural ambition aligns with the Community Empowerment Act and think about the opportunities there, particularly around how we support local authorities in really kind of drastic budget times and what we can do in terms of the high street and empty house, empty lots and empty shops and where culture can play a role there in a more strategic collegiate approach there with local authority working as well.
Good points, and I know the Culture and Communities report has been mentioned by a number of contributors, but one of our recommendations in that is about cultural representation and community planning partnership levels. So the government's yet to respond to that, so that should happen soon. I'm going to move to questions from Mr. Ruskell, please.
Yeah, thanks very much. I'm aware of time, and it has been a really enlightening session. I've got loads and loads of notes and lots of questions, but I'll just focus it on one. I was aware that within the submissions, there was a lot of reflection on transient visitor levy, and obviously you see that as an opportunity to invest in culture. But I think the point was made that, you know, in straitened times of local authority budgets, councils just might spend that on their statutory duties rather than on kind of discretionary spending on culture. So that was a question to you just about ring fencing and how you think that could proceed. And then just any comments you have about late confirmation of grant and aid budget. I mean, obviously that's been a theme this morning with Creative Scotland, but just if that's being reflected across the sector, has that caused any particular issues in terms of delay of budget that's come in? That was it, really.
Sure, I'll pick on both of those. On the visitor levy, I am not so hopeful, actually, about what will come out of that. It has the potential to do something very positive for culture, but I think an observation that I'm picking up is that the conversation within local authorities is around localism, actually, and it's around very, very specific local benefit as opposed to investment in that core infrastructure. So I think there is a way to go to square those two things. And certainly, Julia perhaps will talk about it more eloquently than I am, but the latest advice from City of Edinburgh Council is that they're seeing that investment definitely not around cultural product that brings tourism into the city, the people that are paying the levy, but it is about local communities and it is about very small scale activity. So there is a disconnect between those two things. So I'm a bit nervous about that. On the late confirmation, that has a huge effect. So again, a real life example. The festival will put to bed the programme for the 2024 festival by Christmas this year. We don't know what our budget is next year. And so what that does is it pushes the risk onto the organisations. And I think, as Ian was saying earlier on this morning, it causes our boards and it causes our auditors to have some very uncomfortable questions about going concern. And if you've got a situation where the National Development Agency, funding agency, national organisations, international organisations, and I'm sure all the way down, all the way through, are having conversations about are they going concerns, the system is fundamentally broken. And so that's why I come back to the point about ambition and strategy. We can't keep just twiddling at the edges and hoping that we're going to have a different outcome. The system is broken. We need a fundamental reset that is ambitious and in line with the overall ambitions that have been shown in other policy areas. I think that's where we need to get to.
I'm really just repeating what Francis says in a way, but that going concern issue, it's extraordinary, isn't it, really, that our national organisations are having those conversations at board level and boards feel unconfident to sign off annual accounts. Quite extraordinary. Mid-year, you know, we're moving towards, in a positive way, hopefully, pay negotiation with our staff, but it's corrosive to our ability to recruit and our ability to reward our colleagues appropriately. And I think there is a real risk of continuing industrial unrest within the culture sector as a result of that uncertainty and being able to settle for our colleagues. And then that 3-year, you know, we need a 3-year planning horizon for almost everything that we do. We cannot be ambitious in the way that we want to be ambitious when we're not sure what's coming in the next 2 months, year on year. So It's a really challenging time, and I would love to spend more of my time out doing those creative things rather than worrying about the next month's budgets. So,
anyone else want to come in on those points, or have we been covered by Fran and Chris? Thanks. I'll move then to, if Mark, are you okay? I'll move to Mr. Brown. Thanks. Keith, thanks.
Thank you much. I'm quite new to the committee, and I'm just stunned about how unremittingly bleak this experience has been, although has been made lighter by the really high-quality analogies used in aquatic ones and ones about climate change, which are better than any other committee I've been on. I think, going to the financial pressures and the international aspect is quite interesting. So we heard about high interest rates, we heard about inflation, we heard about Brexit and energy costs, one of them 400% increase in energy costs. I think you brushed over those quite quickly, the implications, because implications will be for the Scottish Government across the board, not just in relation to culture. But it was the international aspect, and I think we heard a range. So for the festivals, I think we're pretty much done. The international reputation has gone to the extent that people that come here are shocked and want to give us an aid package, although I heard elsewhere people saying we still had an excellent reputation, I take it that would be for the non-festival sector. So the question, and also there's a couple of examples raised about Canada and Korea, who are vitally different from Scotland in some quite important respects. First of all, they won't have the same extent of the financial pressures I mentioned. And they won't have Brexit, for example. But they're not devolved. They don't have a predetermined budget. So rather than get answers to this question just now, it would be useful if people can give, and there was some reference to London, which is not quite as relevant as it might be, but to devolved, whether in Europe or in the UK, what the situation is there. If people are able to provide any information on that, I would certainly find it useful. And the only other thing I wanted to raise was Mark Ruskell's question in relation to transient visitor levy. I think there is potential there, but I wonder if it might end up having a very unequal impact given what the likely dividends would be for different local authorities across the country. And for my part, I wouldn't be averse to trying to safeguard. I think we heard that there's real danger that it might just go into core funding. There's ways it could be safeguarded. Local authorities would rail against ring fencing, but it may be through the Verity House Agreement and others you can get some agreement. But would it not be the case it might just strengthen those areas which are already strong and do very little for areas with, you know, especially more rural dispersed population areas? It'd be interesting. Any thoughts on that?
70. Julia?
Thank you. I think it's always valuable to look at that wider context, and particularly with the international comparators. And I think for Edinburgh's festivals, what comes through when people visit us is that they are absolutely astonished at what Scotland is able to achieve, given the constraints that you've just described. Their desire to help us is because this is an asset that is really, really important to them, as well as really, really important to Scotland as a nation. So I think that we should take that as a point of strength that we have to build on for the future, rather than a feeling that we are now past the point of no return. We also deal with regions such as Catalonia and Flanders and Quebec, who are very strong partners for us and share work with us, exchange work with us very regularly. And I guess some of the things that they have that support the culture sector more is statutes, about the status of the artist, about the status of itinerant workers when they're not on active jobs. So I think for the long term, we can definitely build up those policy relationships with those comparators to help us understand how, as a currently non-state actor, we can strengthen that relationship. And I think for the whole of the country, the questions about how the creative workforce is nurtured can benefit from that kind of analysis, because
as a lot of us have been saying, people who work in the performing arts, they also work in the screen sector, and we've seen how the focus on the screen sector has hugely benefited Scotland's economy and Scotland's workforce. That's not being backfilled at the moment. You know, the increased demand that there is for those kinds of technicians is not being backfilled into other bits of the creative sector. So, you know, by working within the country and with some of those international partners, I hope that we might be able to safeguard a talent pipeline and start to regrow a talent pipeline for the future. So that's just an example, I think, of how we can harness some of those relationships.
Okay. Does anyone else want to add anything?
What I was really keen to find out, though, was in relation to other devolved areas, where if there's something the Scottish Government could be doing with the powers it's got, which are quite different from Quebec and Catalonia, whether it's in terms of taxation and other things, if there are things that the Scottish Government is not doing that it has the power to do, or there are analogies which portray the Scottish Government either favourably or unfavourably to give us a better picture of what they could be doing. And if anybody's able to provide that in writing at a subsequent day, that would be quite useful.
If I may. We've had some good discussions with civil servants about that around the international cultural strategy. So I think quite a lot of us around the table have probably submitted some material about that. So I'd be delighted if we haven't heard anything about the international cultural strategy for quite some months. But if people wanted to revive that discussion and have a go at some of those questions, be very happy to take part.
Conscious we've run right up against time, so if there's no more questions, I just thank you to everyone for coming along for the evidence session today, and as always for your submissions in writing beforehand, which are really helpful to the committee for today's session. And on that note, I'm going to close this meeting of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee.